Alzheimer's is a particularly devastating disease because it often involves memory loss and severe cognitive dysfunction to the point that individuals won't even recognize their loved ones.
Alzheimer's disease is very common. The strongest risk factor for Alzheimer's disease is age. And so as our population ages, Alzheimer's disease is becoming much more prevalent.
Alzheimer's probably represents one of the biggest societal costs and personal costs today. It is a huge threat to our society. The societal burden, the financial burden, the human costs cannot be overstated. And this is the big one we need to deal with, especially as people are living longer, the cost rises ever higher.
The CAD Project stands for the Seattle Alzheimer's Brain Cell Atlas Project. This is a Seattle-based consortium project that brings together organizations at the University of Washington, Kaiser Permanente, and the Allen Institute to collectively try to apply cutting-edge tools to get a new understanding of Alzheimer's disease pathology.
We don't really understand how Alzheimer's disease starts. We do understand generally the parts of the brain that are affected earlier in disease than late. And so that's the area that we've tried to focus on, especially with the CAD project, which is to look in areas of the brain that are affected really early in Alzheimer's disease, and even look at areas of the brain affected later, but in a way that will give us hints as far as which neurons, which cells are more vulnerable.
If one looks in any other organ, diseases are typically diseases of particular types of cells in those organs. There's every reason to believe that this is the case in the brain as well. We now have the tools to finally look at this level of resolution and try to address that very question. What kinds of cells are affected by disease or are causal for disease? And it turns out that there are several types of cells that seem to be selectively vulnerable. One of them are the cells that project from one region of the cortex to another region of the cortex. They make long-range connections from across the cortex. These types of connections are thought to underlie highly associative thinking or high cognitive function.
Ultimately, Alzheimer's disease comes down to brain function, the effects of it, and brain function is a product of the cells that you have in your brain and what they're doing, who they're talking to. We know that there are some cells during Alzheimer's disease more vulnerable than others. What we need the cell maps for is to know where those cells are and what other cells they might be interacting with spatially so that we can put the whole picture together about where the cells are and who they're talking to.
The beauty of the current approach is that relies so much on these so-called omics techniques, where we get a molecular definition of the cells, we know what they look like, we know what their properties are, we know what genes they express, we know what proteins they express. That means that we can not only identify this is a cell type that we care about, but we also have a way in. We have a molecular handle on getting access to those cells and maybe understanding a bit more about how they function.
I think the thing that impresses me the most about this data set and this study is that we're taking very generous donors who have decided to be a part of this study and looking at several data modalities for the same donor. That gives us the opportunity to compare at various levels of disease severity and also across people that might come from different backgrounds, which gives us a better chance to find the truth about the disease process.
Given the wealth of data coming from the single nucleus sequencing and the spatial omics, we feel like it's really our responsibility to try to do as much as we can to quantify the burden of pathology across each of these donors' brains. Our job is to honor this incredible gift that they have given to science by learning as much as possible from every person, from every donor, from every part of their brain.
The work that's been done on this atlas is really remarkable in that it's shown us the extraordinary numbers of cell types that are in the brain, and the great numbers of those which are increased or decreased in number in Alzheimer's disease, and the great number which are altered in their basic pathology, gene expression, other profiles. And these gave previously unknowable richness of events that occur and then become targets for our intervention.
Because this data will be publicly available, anybody can come in with brilliant ideas and hopefully see things in this data that will give us clues to how this disease works. And so my sincere hope is not just that we'll identify early vulnerable cell types and help develop therapies for Alzheimer's disease, but that we'll be able to address the broad landscape of neurological disorders, both age-related and dementia-related, but beyond that, brain disorders in general.